Hello everyone, this is my third video on general embryology. In this video, I'll be talking about the third and fourth week of embryonic development. Third and fourth week of development includes appearance of primitive streak, a process called as gastrulation, where the bilamina germ disc will be converted into three layers. So these three layers forms the germ layers. Then there will be development of notochord. There will be a process of formation of neural tube called as neurulation. And there will be differentiation of the three germ layers. Case 1. A 10-year-old baby boy presented with a mature sacrococcygeal teratoma comprising well-developed lower limb, rudimentary external genitalia and teeth. He had complete surgical excision and uneventful post-operative recovery. The mother was told this tumor starts to develop in the third week of intrauterine life as remnant of primitive streak. So you can see here, this is the tumor, the sacrococcygeal teratoma. So there are all kinds of tissues present there. So this is a tumor due to the remnant of primitive streak. So what is primitive streak? Why does this tumor has different structure? You'll come to know once you know the normal third week of development. The orientation of cephalocaudal ends. Before the third week starts, I had told in my earlier video on second week of embryonic development that there'll be formation of precaudal plate. So the formation of precaudal plate represents the cranial end of the embryo. So here is the formation of precaudal plate, where the few cells in the hypoblast layer become columnar in nature and they become thick, adherent to the overlying epiblast, and this forms the precaudal plate, which represents the cranial end of the embryo, and also it is an organizer for the development of head region. So this represents the cranial end of the disc, and the other side, the opposite side, will be the caudal end of the disc. So caudal end, it is represented by a diverticulum. So the posterior wall of the yolk sac. So you can see here, this is the disc, bilaminar germ disc. Above that is the amniotic cavity, and below is the yolk sac. So the posterior wall of the yolk sac will form a small diverticulum which enters the connecting stalk. So this is the connecting stalk. So I had told in my earlier video, connecting stalk is the area where the germ disc is connected to the trophoblast. So this small diverticulum will be called as allantois. So the presence of allantois and the connecting stalk represents the caudal end of the disc, and the presence of precaudal plate represents the cranial end of the disc. So this I had shown in my earlier video, the formation of precaudal plate. So gastrulation, it's a very characteristic event occurring in the third week of embryonic development. So here, the gastrulation is a process where the two layers will be converted into three germ layers. So the process by which the three germ layers, which are the precursors of all embryonic tissue, and axial orientations are established in the embryo. So gastrulation, so you can see, the bilaminar embryonic disc will be converted into trilaminar embryonic disc. So bilaminar will include epiblast and hypoblast. So once it is converted into trilaminar germ disc, it will form the ectoderm, mesoderm and endoderm. So during this period, the embryo will be called as gastrula. So once the fusion has occurred between male and female gametes, the resultant fertilized egg will be called as zygote. Then they form, there will be cleavage, there will be mitotic division, and there will be a stage called as 16 cell stage, that time it will be called as morula. Then there will be formation of a cavity within the morula, and that will be called as blastocyst. And once the gastrulation process starts, so that time the embryo will be called as gastrula. So gastrulation begins with the formation of a streak called as primitive streak. So how this primitive streak is formed? So please understand this picture here. So you can see this is a cut section where you can see the amniotic sac above, the yolk sac below, and here is the disc, the bilaminar germ disc. The blue one represents the epiblast and the yellow one represents the hypoblast. So you can imagine this is two balloons. If you imagine two balloons, one blue and yellow, and if you take a section here, so this is the disc which is shown in this picture. So where they have taken the cut section of the two balloons, they have removed the upper balloon and the lower balloon, and now they are focusing only the disc which is having the epiblast and the hypoblast layer. So on the layer of epiblast, there will be formation of a narrow streak called as primitive streak. Okay, so there will be a narrow line formation which is called as primitive streak. So initially this streak won't be much distinguishable, not clearly visible. So as the growth goes on, this streak becomes more clearly visible. The streak will be converted into a groove which becomes clearly visible. So you can see here the streak has become a small groove and having a raised edges on either side. So the cranial end of the streak, so this is the cranial end. As I told, the cranial and the caudal orientation is by seeing the precaudal plate at the cranial aspect and the presence of connecting stalk and allantois on the caudal aspect. So the cranial aspect of the primitive streak, you can see a pit here called as the primitive pit. Okay, so this is the primitive streak. Then at the cranial end, there will be a pit called as primitive pit, which is surrounded by a raised margin called as primitive node. So the process of gastrulation starts with the formation of primitive streak, and there will be formation of primitive node and primitive pit. So the cells from the epiblast, so here they all, not all the cells, the few cells of the epiblast, they move, they migrate towards the primitive streak and they start invaginating. So you can see here the cells of the epiblast, they migrate towards the primitive streak and they start. So if you take a section here at the level of primitive streak and if you turn it, so you can see here this is the epiblast layer, this is the hypoblast layer. Exactly at the primitive streak area, few of the epiblast cells, they start invaginating through the groove. So they become flask shaped and they start invaginating, and slowly they get detached from the overlying epiblast. So you can see here the migration. So this process is called as the inward movement of the cells is called as invagination. So the cells which are invaginating, they become flask shaped and slowly get detached from the overlying epiblast layer. Then the cells which are detached, they displace the cells of the hypoblast. So you can see here they are displacing the cells of the hypoblast, converting the hypoblast layer into embryonic endoderm. Then few other cells, they start moving laterally and cranially and they form a separate layer between the epiblast and newly formed endoderm, and that will be called as intraembryonic mesoderm. And the remaining cells present in the epiblast layer will be converted into embryonic ectoderm. So this is how the epiblast layer forms a source for the formation of all the three germ layers, that is the ectoderm, mesoderm and endoderm. And the cells which are present in the epiblast have the capacity to form different types of tissues and organs. So epiblast is the one which is very much important in the gastrulation, and it is a source for the formation of all the three germ layers. So this is a streak. So first morphological sign of gastrulation appears on the surface of the epiblast, and they move, you can see here, caudally in the medial plane, and they move towards cranial end, and they stop abruptly, and there will be formation of primitive pit and primitive node. So this occurs during 15th day of embryonic development. So the parts of the primitive streak includes the primitive groove, primitive pit, and the raised margin around the pit called as primitive node. This is the formation of primitive streak, and the cells from the epiblast detaching from the epiblast layer. Then they change their shape into flask shaped, and they have a migrating property because they develop pseudopodia. So epiblast is a source for the formation of ectoderm, mesoderm and endoderm. So this is an animation showing the process of invagination, that is the inward movement of the cells. The mesenchymal cells, so what do you mean by mesenchymal cells? So the cells of the embryonic tissue, the loose connective tissue cells of the embryo will be called as mesenchymal cells. So majorly they are from the mesoderm, so they are derived from the primitive streak and they migrate widely around. So you can see the migration, that is the intraembryonic mesoderm, they migrate laterally and also cranially, separating the ectoderm from the endoderm. But except in few areas, so which are mentioned here, the mesoderm is not seen where the oropharyngeal membrane is formed, that is caudal to the precaudal plate. So here will be the precaudal plate. So caudal to the precaudal plate, there will be oropharyngeal membrane where the ectoderm and endoderm are tightly adherent. So at that area, we won't be seeing the migration of mesoderm, there won't be any mesoderm. Then at the caudal end, there will be one more membrane just like oropharyngeal membrane. So that will be called as cloacal membrane. Again, there will be adherent of ectoderm and endoderm in this region, and there won't be any mesoderm. And also there will be formation of notochord from the primitive node till the precaudal plate. There will be formation of one more cord like structure called as notochord. So at that area also, there won't be mesoderm. Okay, so more and more cells begin to spread laterally and cranially, and the mesoderm, intraembryonic mesoderm, is formed between the ectoderm and the endoderm, excluding at the oropharyngeal membrane area, cloacal membrane area, and at the area where the notochord is formed. So if you take a section here, so you can see this is the notochord formation exactly at the midline. So on either side you see the mesoderm, but at the center, at the midline, the mesoderm is not present. So what happens to the primitive streak? So the embryo, as there is migration of cells, the mesodermal cells, and there will be formation of three germ layers, the embryonic disc will elongate and grow further. So as they elongate and grow further, the primitive streak becomes more caudal, and they regress and they shrink, and finally they disappear. So this is the fate of the primitive streak. So you can see here, this is on the 15th day. As the days proceed, the embryonic disc, they keep on elongating and they grow further, and you can see the primitive streak becomes smaller, they regress in size, they shrink, and finally they have to disappear. So undergoes degeneration and disappears by the end of fourth week. So if it remains, if it doesn't regress or shrink, or if it doesn't disappear, it leads to a condition called as sacrococcygeal teratoma, which I had told about a case where the baby had a tumor at the caudal end. Okay, so this is due to the, this is resulting from the remnants of primitive streak. So these tumors, since the primitive streak have the capacity, because primitive streak is formed on the surface of the epiblast cells, and I had told earlier, the cells which are migrating towards the primitive streak have the capacity to form different kinds of tissues and organs. So since these cells are pluripotent, so the tumor contain elements of germ layers which are incomplete in stages of differentiation. So they, you can see the all kinds of tissues in this tumor. So this is called as sacrococcygeal teratoma, which is due to the remains of primitive streak. Now let us know the development of notochord. So what is a notochord? So this is a solid cord of cells which extends from the primitive node. So this is the primitive spit here, where the cells are invaginating to form the three germ layers. So from the primitive pit or the primitive node till the precordal plate, there will be migration of epiblast cells. Okay, so these cells, they are specialized cells exactly at the midline, and these will be called as pre-notochordal cells. So they extend from primitive node, move cranially till the precordal plate. So this is the precordal plate. Okay, so till there, the pre-notochordal cells, they migrate and they get intercalated with the hypoblast, the underlying endoderm. So you can see here, so the formation of notochord and the primitive streak will go hand in hand. It is not that the primitive streak is formed first and later notochord. So they are forming simultaneously. Okay, so the pre-notochordal cells which are present in between the ectoderm and underlying endoderm, so they intercalated, these pre-notochordal cells, they get intercalated with the hypoblast layer. That so initially there will be epiblast and hypoblast. There won't be formation of three germ layers when the notochord is forming, because this is in the third week. So they get intercalated with the hypoblast cells, and once the hypoblasts are converted into endoderm, these notochordal plates, so this will be called, it will be like a plate when they are intercalated with the hypoblast. So this notochordal plate, they get detached from the newly formed endoderm and they form a solid cord like structure called as notochord, and this extends from the primitive node till the precordal plate in the midline. So at this area where notochord is formed, there won't be intraembryonic mesoderm. So this indicates, the formation of notochord indicates the future site of vertebral bodies, and it also acts as a primary inducer which induces the overlying ectoderm to form the neural plate, which will give rise to the brain and the spinal cord. Okay, so the formation of notochord is also an important step in the development, third week embryonic development, because this is an indication for the future site of axial skeleton, that is the vertebral bodies, and also they stimulate the overlying epiblast cells, that is, sorry, not the epiblast, the ectoderm. Now the ectoderm is formed, so overlying ectoderm to form a neural plate. So, and that process is called as formation of neural plate and neural tube is called as neurulation. Before I proceed with the further development, you have to know few sections of the embryonic disc. So initially the embryonic disc will be circular, around in shape. As the growth increases, they become oblong, that is the cephalic end grows further and they become broader and the caudal end becomes narrower. So here This is a clay model showing the three germ layers. The blue one represents the epiblast, which later forms the ectoderm. Then the red one represents the intraembryonic mesoderm, and the yellow one, which was hypoblast before gastrulation, later gets converted into endoderm. So these are the three germ layers which are formed after the gastrulation. Okay, so you have to know a few of the sections. So this is the cephalic end, this is the caudal end. So in the pictures, sometimes they might take a sagittal section. So sagittal section is taken like this, where you can see both the cephalic and the caudal end. Okay, and some sections are transverse section in order to know. So this is a transverse section. So if it is taken at here, the transverse section, and if it is detached like this, so you can see the ectoderm layer, the mesoderm and the endoderm. Okay, so it is reflected like this. The transverse section is taken, and if it is reflected, you can see the picture will be shown like this. And in the center, you can see a whitish color area, which is the notochord. Okay, so as I told, the mesoderm are not formed in three major areas. One at the cephalic end, where the oropharyngeal membrane is formed. One at the caudal end, where cloacal membrane is formed. And one at the center, where the notochord is formed. So this notochord induces the overlying ectoderm to form the neural plate, and this neural plate later forms the neural tube, which is present, which will be formed above the notochord. Okay, so this you have to remember, the sections, because if you understand the section, it is easy to understand the concepts of embryonic development. So I would like to show even in a paper model. So this is the disc. So if you imagine, there are two balloons, one on the up, which is called the amniotic sac, one below will be the yolk sac. So if you take a cut section here, cut the balloon here, you will see the disc. Okay, so here the color have changed. So the pink one represents the ectoderm, the red one represents the mesoderm, and the yellow one represents the endoderm. So this is the disc. Okay, on the surface of the epiblast, there will be formation of primitive streak. Okay, so when you see here, this is the mesoderm. As I told, the mesoderm are present, they migrate laterally and cranially, and they separate the overlying ectoderm from the endoderm, except at the three areas where the notochord is formed. One at the oropharyngeal membrane, the other one, which will be caudal, which I have not shown here, at the caudal area where the cloacal membrane is formed. So this is how the disc is present in the embryo. Now let us know the fate of each germ layer, starting with the fate of ectoderm. So before we go into the development of the ectoderm, we'll know a case. So there are two images here. So images are showing two common types of neural tube defects, which are most commonly occurs in mothers having folic acid deficiency during pregnancy. So what is a neural tube, and how it develops, and what are the structures developing from this tube, you will come to know. And what is the role of folic acid in the neural tube development? So this is a picture showing spina bifida. So here you can see at the back side, and here at the cranial end you can see anencephaly. So ectoderm will differentiate into two layers. One at the midline, they form the neuroectoderm, and the remaining will form the surface ectoderm. So the neuroectoderm is formed by a process called as neurulation. So this is a process involved in the formation of neural tube. Neural tube is the one which later forms the brain at the cranial part, and the tube, the remaining tube, forms the spinal cord. The neurulation begins at the end of third week and completes by the end of fourth week. So For the process, for this process, the neurulation, it's very important for the formation of a notochord, because notochord is the one which induces the overlying ectoderm located at or adjacent to the midline to thicken and form an elongated neural plate of thickened epithelial cells. So you can see here again. Now you should remember the picture. So this is the disc. So if the section is taken, the transverse section is taken, and if it is reflected, so you can see here. So this is the red one, represents the notochord. So it induces the overlying the ectoderm and some at the either side. So they become thick. The cells become thick, and this forms the neural plate. So later, this neural plate, they start invaginating inside. Okay, so the neural plate invaginates along its central axis to form a groove. So initially it will be a plate. Okay, then they invaginate slowly and this forms a groove. So once this groove is formed, the dipping is called as the neural groove. On either side, there will be elevated edges which will be called as neural fold. So adjacent to the neural fold, there are some cells which are called as neural crest cells. These are specialized cells which have a definitive function. Okay, so neural plate will form a dipping at the midline called a neural groove, and there will be raised edges on either side which will be called as neural fold, and adjacent to the neural fold there are some specialized cells called as neural crest cells. So this, by the end of third week, the neural folds will come closer and they fuse together. So you can see here the neural folds which are present, the raised margin, they slowly come together and they fuse, and the groove after fusion, they get detached from the overlying ectoderm and this forms the neural tube. So converting the neural plate into neural tube. The neural tube soon separates from the surface ectoderm, and the cells which are present here near the neural fold, which were called as neural crest cells, they also detach from the surface ectoderm and they are present on either side of the neural tube. So again, this picture is showing, this is the disc. So here the neural groove formation, and from neural groove they form a tube and get detached from the surface ectoderm. So this is the neural tube and this one is the notochord. So once the neural tube detaches, and once the neural, there will be the fusion of neural folds, they occur from cranial to caudal end, and at two ends the neural tube will be in continuity with the amniotic cavity. So these two opening ends will be called as cranial neuropore and caudal neuropore. So initially the neural tube has two opening at its end called as cranial and caudal neuropores. Neurulation is complete when both the neuropores closes. So when does it close? It has to close. The cranial neuropore closes at approximately 25th day and caudal neuropore on 27th day. So this is the neural crest which are separating, detaching from the surface ectoderm, and they are present on either side. So these are specialized cells, okay, special cell population present at the lateral border or the crest of the neuroectoderm. So they get dissociated from their neighbors, that is while the neural fold is elevating and fusing each other to form the neural tube. See, these special cells, they undergo epithelial to mesenchymal transition, and they leave the neuroectoderm. They have a capacity of migrating, and they migrate throughout the embryo to many specific locations in the body, giving rise to variety of structures. So those structures are, they give rise to melanocytes, which produces a pigment, the melanin pigment. Then they also form the cells of sensory, cranial and autonomic ganglia. The ganglia, which are group of cell bodies present outside the central nervous system. So they are derived from neural crest cells. Then the Schwann cells, which helps in myelinating the peripheral nervous system. Then cells of the adrenal medulla. Then craniofacial skeletal structures. Then the meninges, that is the layer of connective tissue surrounding the brain and the spinal cord. So all these are derived from neural crest cells. So this is the neural tube defect. So if the neural tube fails to close in the cranial region, as I told, there will be two openings, one at the cranial and the caudal end, which are called as cranial and the caudal neuropore. So if the cranial neuropore doesn't fuse, doesn't close, so that will be open and there will be abnormal development of brain. So that defect is called as anencephaly. So this is one of the neural tube defect. And if the closure anywhere at the caudal end fails, see, if closure fails anywhere from the cervical region till which extends till caudally, then that defect will be called as spina bifida. So these are the two neural tube defects which can be seen in babies. So they say that this can be very common in mothers having folic acid deficiency. Folic acid is very much necessary for the development of the neural tube. So that's why the doctors, the obstetrician, advise the mothers to have, along with iron tablets, the folic acid is also given around 400 microgram. And they also advise the female, if they are planning to conceive, to become pregnant, it is better to have folic acid 3 months before they plan to conceive, because folic acid plays a major role in the development of neural tube, that is neurulation. So now coming to the fate of the mesoderm. Baby was stillborn and was having fused lower extremities and other abnormalities. It was due to insufficient mesoderm formation in the caudal most region of the embryo. So this condition is called as caudal dysgenesis or cerinomelia. So what is the fate of the mesoderm? What are the structures developing from the mesoderm? You will come to know now. So the mesoderm differentiates the intraembryonic. So why I am specifying here intraembryonic? Because I had told in my earlier video, outside the embryo there is one more layer of mesoderm, loose connective tissue, which is called as extraembryonic. But this is within the embryo, so this is called as embryonic mesoderm or intraembryonic mesoderm, which will differentiate into three parts or three layers: paraaxial, intermediate and lateral plate mesoderm. So here you can see again in this picture, this is the neural tube, sorry, this is the notochord and this is the neural groove, and on either side of the notochord the layer of mesoderm will be called as paraaxial. As I told, this forms axial skeleton. So these are present on either side of the axis. So these are called as paraaxial mesoderm. Then you see the intermediate mesoderm and lateral most will be the lateral mesoderm. So the intermediate mesoderm, which lies lateral to paraaxial mesoderm, will give rise to urogenital system. So they are majorly involved in the formation of renal, that is the kidney and the urinary tract and also genital tract. Then the lateral plate mesoderm, when you see they are lateral most, they are continuous with the extraembryonic mesoderm, which is surrounding around the yolk sac and the amniotic cavity. So they give rise to the body wall, which includes peritoneal cavity, pleural cavity and the pericardial cavity, and also it gives contribution for the wall of the digestive tract and the limbs. So the paraaxial mesoderm, so on either side there will be formation of specialized structure called as somites. So these are blocks of cells that are formed by segmentation. So it will be like a brick. When you layer the brick one above the other, so just like that it is seen. So you will see blocks of cells present in which are formed in the paraxial mesoderm, and they are segmented, and these are called as somites. So they appear from the rostral to caudal in a sequence, not simultaneously, in a sequence. And the cranial most one, which are present at the cephalic aspect, they are called as somatomeres, that is from 1 to 7, and the rest are called as somites. So they appear one by one. So when you see at the 20 days embryo, there will be only few somites on either side. As the days increases, the number also increases. So in the somites, there are three groups of cells. So some cells contributes for the formation of the dermis, which is a layer of skin. So those cells are called as dermatomes. Some form the sclerotome and some form the myotome. So sclerotome gives rise to tendon, cartilage and bone, that is the vertebrae and the ribs. Dermatome gives rise to dermis of the skin, and myotome will give rise to muscles. So these are present, these cells are present in the somites. So you can see in this picture, so some cells, they form the dermis of the skin, dermatome, this is myotome which forms the muscles, and there are few cells. So this is dermatome, this is myotome, and these are sclerotome, which gives rise to vertebrae and the ribs, the cartilage also. Now coming to the lateral plate mesoderm. So this lateral plate mesoderm, they are divided into two more layers, okay, by formation of a cavity here called as intraembryonic coelom. Okay, in the lateral plate, there will be formation of small cavities which will fuse to form a larger one, which is called as intraembryonic cavity, which divides the lateral plate mesoderm into two areas. One which is adjacent to the ectoderm will be called as somatic mesoderm, and the one which is adjacent to the endoderm area is called as splanchnic mesoderm. So somatic, also called as parietal layer, they are located beneath the ectoderm, and splanchnic or visceral layer located adjacent to the endoderm. So the case which I had told, that is the sirenomelia or the caudal dysgenesis, as I told, the mesoderm are formed from the layer of epiblast. So this mesoderm has to migrate throughout the embryonic disc. So as I told, they have moved laterally, cranially, okay, initially they move cranially and slowly they also come towards at the caudal end. So as I told, the cranial end grows first, they are broader compared to the caudal end. So if there is insufficient migration of mesoderm or insufficient mesoderm formation at the caudalmost region of the embryo, so there will be defect in the formation of lower limb, then the urogenital system, and also the lumbosacral vertebra, because all these are developed from the mesoderm. Okay, so if there is insufficient mesoderm at the caudalmost area, so there will be deficiency in the formation of all these structures. The cause can be genetic also, and usually the baby won't survive, and this condition is called as caudal dysgenesis or sirenomelia. Now coming to the endoderm, so I won't be going in detail because as I told earlier, the endoderm gives contribution for the development of the pharyngeal arches and also the digestive tract, which I have done a separate video on the development of gastrointestinal tract. So I'll be just here telling the endoderm gives contribution for the development of the digestive tract. So you can see that video, that is the development of gastrointestinal system, for the further description of endoderm development. So once these three layers are formed, the embryo is elongating, they are growing more, and the embryo has to occupy, they are increasing in size. So it has to be occupied in a smaller space. The embryo undergoes folding. Okay, so the folding of the embryo is a significant event that transforms the flat trilaminar embryonic disc into a cylindrical embryo. So the folding occurs at the cephalocaudal region and also at the lateral, that is the horizontal plane, due to the rapid growth of the embryo. So after the folding occurs, the embryo lies within the amniotic cavity. Before, the amniotic cavity was present only above the disc. So once the folding occurs at the both the areas, cephalocaudal and lateral area, so the embryo will be present within the amniotic cavity, because the cavity also enlarges and covers around the embryo, and the ventral body wall closes completely except for the umbilical region, where the connecting stalk and yolk sac duct remain attached. Okay, so complete, there will be complete closure except at the umbilical region, where you can see two stalks. One is the connecting stalk and a duct called as yolk sac duct, which is communicating. So this is how the folding occurs. This is a sagittal section showing the cephalic and the caudal end. Okay, so this is the amniotic cavity, this is the yolk sac. So the folding is occurring at the cephalocaudal area, and slowly the amniotic cavity is enlarging and surrounding and around the embryonic disc. So the ventral wall will close, only there will be a communication in the midline through the umbilical region. This is the lateral folding, that is at the horizontal plane, where there will be complete closure and the endoderm will be present within the amniotic cavity. So this completes the third and fourth week of embryonic development. The reference is the Langman Medical Embryology. Thank you. The development of placenta I will be covering in a separate video, which I have not discussed in these three videos. So there will be a separate video on the development of placenta and about the multiple pregnancies.